Thank you. Oh, is that the volume of this? Because it's really going to need to be loud enough. I mean, here. Hello. Yeah, crank it up a bit. Hi. I don't know really how what we're supposed to do. You can ask questions, I can play songs, or you've probably heard enough of me.
Play a song.
Yeah, all right. Does anyone want to ask me anything?
Yeah, it's I've got a mic over here, so let's... Actually, before we get into this, Nick, how was over on your opposite side? We all just watched the film about you. How is that process? I mean, it seemed invasive. Your quote in there with songwriting, you edit viciously. Did you apply that same mentality to the film? Or did you let Ian and Jane do that?
I let Ian and Jane basically do their thing, but had a kind of, I could chop it up as well. So, you know, there was a safety net for me. So I basically went into it, eventually once I sort of gave myself over to the idea of doing the film, which took a fair bit of convincing ones, I gave myself to fully the idea with the idea that I could also chop anything that I didn't like out of the film out. So, and actually it wasn't that much, it went really.
We've got a gentleman in the middle, you were the first with your hand up, so I'll pass the microphone down if you can.
Hello. for taking the time to speak with us, and it was a great movie.
Thank you.
There's so much in that movie about memory, and I have so many great memories of the Boatman's Call, so I wanted to say thank you for that album.
Do you want me to play something from it?
If you wouldn't mind, I'd really appreciate it.
Is that what you wanted to ask me, or do you want to ask me something more complicated?
Yeah, I did want to ask you if you had a favorite memory or anything associated with making that album.
Oh, God. Oh, boy. Which one is it? It's the one with the black and white cover.
Yes.
Robbed an orchard.
Yeah. Oh, that was a tragic time. There was like a kind of a relay race of apocalyptic problems around that time, and that song, that record kind of comes out of that thing. But it's got some very kind of pretty songs on it too, you know, so anyway, I'll play. Okay. This is I've finished a North American tour, and this event has been kind of put on at the very end, so I'm kind of hysterical, completely shattered, and so please
you're not the only one.
Help me get sing along in the choruses, ask me questions, make a lot of noise, it will all be helpful.
Thank you.
Thank you, thank you. Can we put some reverb on the voice? I'm sorry about this. It sounds, I sound like fucking Johnny Rotten.
Hear you play tonight in this setting. Thank you for being with us. And thank you for a great tour with Push a Skyway. It was incredible seeing you out here. So thank you for being with us.
Thank you.
I just have a question. In the film, you talked about Brighton, and I was sort of surprised to see that, you know, Brighton became almost a character in the film. And your relationship to the weather and Brighton, it sort of reminded me of another artist that I love, Pete Townsend, who sort of fell in with Brighton, and it became a big element of the story in Quadrophenia. And so I guess my question is, you said that it happened to you and it sort of sounded like a fated event, and I'm just curious, what in your life drew, when did you become drawn to Brighton? How did that happen?
My wife wanted to go. And so we went. That's pretty much some whole thing after them. It took me, I'm a country boy and I don't have any relationship with the sea whatsoever. I grew up by a river, you know, in the middle of the, you know, in Victoria. I never really got the whole beach thing, even as an Australian, that kind of the way the water goes back and forward and back. That, I never kind of got that. I prefer the sort of flowing river and all that sort of stuff. So I didn't want to go, to be honest. But I really love it now. I have really no choice.
She jumped up out of the seat, so here we go. Here's the mic, so middle of the room.
Hi, Nick.
Hi.
I was at the show at the Man, and I had the honor of touching your butt. So I'm gonna be wrong.
That was you, was it? I'm coming for you. I second this sexual harassment.
You're not a kid anymore. How do you keep yourself in such amazing shape?
That's a very flattering question. I'm glad you think I'm in amazing shape and for confirming my suspicions. But I don't know, I don't exercise, I don't do anything like that. I just go on tour and have a kind of mild heart attack the first 4 or 5 gigs, and then you kind of get fit.
We're at the back of the room stage left. If you want to stand up, sir. Thank you for being here with us tonight and for doing this.
Thank you.
In most of your shows with the bad seeds, you play the mercy seat. And I was wondering, is it fair to think that this is your favorite song? Can you talk to us a little bit about the song? What do you think about Johnny Cash's rendition of it? Any chance you might play for us?
Thank you. Sure. The thing about the mercy seat, I'll do this quickly because you don't know shit. But anyway, basically, I was writing this book and the Astor saw the angel, and I was not writing any songs, and I was deep into the book, and I just kept scribbling this stuff on in the kind of margins really that end up being the mercy seat. So it kind of came out in a very crab-like way without much thought, and it just became this kind of big song, and it's always been with us. It works no matter what we're going through, what musical style we're kind of pushing at any particular time. It seems to be forever alive, and it has its own kind of life each time we play it, so we continue to play it. Not all songs do that. You know, some you write and they don't last very long at all. But the Mercy Seat has. So. And it was great that Johnny Cash recorded, of course.
My head is wild, and I
just really quickly, Nick, thinking about the film and the sequences in the car between Kylie and you're there with Ray, and then there's a scene with Blixa, they all really start to contrast. How was it, that process of being in these tight confines with them and the relationship you had with all those people?
Well, they're all different, obviously. Ian and Jane made very, they went to great lengths to keep us apart before we actually went into the car. So I hadn't seen Kylie in a long time. I had a really very beautiful relationship with Kylie. We drifted apart, she went on to do whatever, and we were just from different worlds, really. So I kind of run into her every now and then, but in a way that we could never talk or whatever. And Blixa, I hadn't really seen since he quit the band. However many years ago it was. He quit the band in a kind of two-line email after being a founder member of the band for many, being in the band an essential part of the band for many years. So there was a kind of, I hadn't really even found out why, to be honest. And Ian and Jane kind of kept us apart and then put us in the car together and sort of filmed it. And we had two 20-minute runs with Kylie. Ray was a different story. I just know Ray, so we just set the car. But so it was quite interesting. It was interesting in that I think more because of people like us were used to being interviewed, used to being filmed, used to speaking. In kind of false situations, actually being in front of the cameras is more comfortable on some level, and you can have, on some level, a more real conversation about things than we can off camera. I think a lot of musicians and a lot of people of our type have quite a lot of difficulty communicating away from, just seeing, two people in a room, so that's the sad truth of it, ladies and gentlemen.
All right, we've got a gentleman all the way at the back. He's on the stage right here.
Thank you. I noticed the image of Elvis Presley at least three times in the movie tonight, and I know that's been subject of your music before. I thought the scene with the girl crying in the front row evoked Elvis Presley, and I just wondered if you could talk about your connection to Elvis and what his music was.
Yeah, like. I mean, look, all I ever wanted to be was Elvis Presley. As a child, I wanted to be Elvis Presley. Until kind of punk rock came along, and then I stopped wanting to be Elvis Presley for a couple of years, and then went back to wanting to be Elvis Presley. he kind of embodied so much more than just a singer, and there was something incredibly moving about his final years to me. His performances were extraordinary in that time and largely dismissed. That there was some other element that was going on when he went on to stage that was so beautiful and brutal at the same time to watch. So I was really swept away by that. And that the whole idea of performance at that level. So he was, he was really always the man. Mm. And we like that bit with the crying girl in the front. It is straight up.
that piece that you talk about there, the beauty and the destruction of Elvis and songwriting in the film, excuse me, you talk about counterpoint. Do you feel that that's affected your own performance and your own songwriting?
Yeah, for sure. You mean the way I write songs?
Yeah.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, that's how I write songs, really. Yes. I don't know what to say, except that, I write a line that sort of means it might be okay, but it kind of doesn't really mean anything. It's a little bit like a single note doesn't really mean anything, but you put another note next to it, so that it kind of suddenly resonates with all sorts of wondrous feelings and stuff like that. I mean, it's much the same with a line. You put one line and you put another line next to it that you may grab from somewhere else, and suddenly the whole kind of, there's a kinetic explosion between the two lines that sparks off something greater than that. So, counterpoint, man.
Okay, next question.
Shall I play a song?
Yeah.
I've never played this before on the piano, right? So. She was a cage. You were a cage. Match that wood, fire or a snake. There was a cage. I was no match. I was fire or a cage. Now I sit around and watch the mermaids sun themselves out on the rocks. They'll be beyond our touch. I'll watch and watch them wave at me. They wave at me. They wave at me back into the sea. I mean, some of the nuns I used to know.
That's why you couldn't have her, because she was a nun. You could never have her.
Man.
And then the other thing is, just my most beautiful song that I think of yours to me is Sweetheart Come, and it's gotten me through many harrowing times, and I don't know if there's any chance you remember the lyrics to it.
Nope. You're thinking of a nun, and you're thinking of a habit, because you had one. Alice wakes here, it is morning. She is, this is about the nun. She is young. She walks about the room. Her hair falls down her breast. She is naked and it is true. Standing at the window, I wonder if she knows that I can see. Watching as rise here after. Up in her past, she's kept it there. Alice's body is golden brown, her hair hangs down. She brushes it 100 times. First she pulls her stand on, and then the church bell chimes. Alice climbs into her uniform, the zipper's on the side. Watching Alice dressing in her room. It's so depressing. It's cruel, slowly. Nothing's real in the film at all, really, apart from the, you know, studio footage and stuff. So I was just put into a set, and they placed pictures in front of me and stuff like that, and I just got to talk about them. And it's not something I do. I'm not nostalgic at all, really. But it did bring out some, you know, it kind of confronted with a lot of these images that I hadn't actually seen. I mean, obviously some I had. Was quite powerful. Yeah. So there you go.
Okay. All right. We've got a gentleman in the middle. Can you stand up, sir?
I've been a fan since early '80s, and I remember back then there was a lot of early mythology that we all would hear about your dislike of urban centers, questions about the Elvis Presley losing his brother before birth, and there were so many rumors and mythologies. You being found missing your first press conference in New York, and how much of any of that was true? And yeah, I'll let you put there.
Not most of it. Yeah, I did the first gig. I think I did in New York. I was in jail. I was supposed to go to the gig, and I got busted down at. Whatever, I remember now. And put in jail for 3 days. It was quite funny, actually, because I was put in a kind of holding tank. I was the only white person in this tank for a lot of black guys. And there was one other white guy, and he ran over to me going, "I'm a gamer!" But even worse was I was staying at the Iroquois Hotel, right? And they called my name, comes beside my mind. They said, "All right, you got one phone call." And I didn't know anyone in New York, but my band was staying at the Iroquois. they said, you know, can you ring the Iroquois Hotel? And they said, can you spell that? And he goes, next! So I had to sit in the jail for 3 days and miss the show. So. Tragic.
Didn't you have a great suit on while you were in jail? It was green.
Yeah, I had a green, vibrant green. Three-piece suit. And we can pick it. Maybe. You mean behind the process?
Yeah.
Yeah, maybe. I mean, I don't, despite what it sounds like, I don't really like to talk about the process too much because it is a very fragile thing for sure. And I don't think it bears up to too much analyzing, really. For me, pretty much, I just turn up and sit down and start to work, and it seems to, if I commit to whatever I'm doing, it seems to work in some kind of way. There's a lot of talk about it there, and you're right. Yeah, maybe. I don't know.
No, it's, like I said, it's not even great. I feel it's extremely inspiring, I have to say. It's like, it really does motivate, at least me personally, when I hear that and I listen to the music and I think about what we talk about. So, thank you for that.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, let's come right down there.
Thank you for being here tonight and the wonderful tour you just completed. Okay, I'm nervous, I'm gonna read one question. You described the film as an opportunity for many truths to emerge within this artificial context that Ian and Jane put together. And I'm wondering if some truth emerged from the film that surprised you, maybe something you didn't know about yourself, and if you would share.
I mean, look, I don't know about that. I mean, I got the opportunity to articulate a lot of things that, you know, I hadn't really thought about. But, you know, they basically, Ian and Jane, who put this film together, they would contact me or email me and say, write something about memory or write something about whatever. And I would just bash out some kind of aphoristic sort of phrases that might be nice spoken over the film, right? And so it's not that I was thinking so much about these things, it was more to kind of, those voiceovers became a kind of engine to push the narrative of the film, really. But they gave me the opportunity to sort of articulate some of that stuff. You know, so. I don't know if I discovered any new stuff, I don't really know what that is.
Hi. I think there's been a bit of a debate for a long time whether you actually believe in God or don't believe in God, and I've read a lot of quotes from you about your thoughts on God, and this film finally seems to answer that you don't believe in it personally.
That was just that day.
The film did say that you do like God to exist in your art form, at least, whether you do believe in him or her personally or not. What do you think a God contributes to your art
form? Well, I mean, I'll just talk about this very quickly, but I'm an artist. I'm a songwriter in particular, and songwriters deal in a different... We're kind of ring-fenced off from the rest of the world and from logic and anything like that. And it's kind of that anything goes within the context of songwriting. And I am, you know, to me, songwriting is by nature about absurd things and magic things. So God fits quite easily into the whole scheme of things, you know. I very much believe in the idea that it's that we should be able to be able to, I find it an endearing aspect of human nature that we create these ideas outside ourselves and aspire to higher things, and often we can be made to feel ashamed of that, and be ashamed of our beliefs and stuff like that. And I personally don't find that very helpful. So to sit there like I did in that and said I don't believe in God, it's a difficult one really to sort of say yes or no to that question, to be honest. I don't really care about God.
I'm
so it's not really, it's I don't really, because belief in God is about trying to find out what is true. And I don't really care about truth so much. I'm much more interested in obfuscation and lies and the darkness that sits underneath things rather than the kind of cold, logical truth. Yeah. And that's because of what I do with songwriting.
There you go.
I'm sounding more and more like some fucking motivational speaker.
Meg, I don't know if you picked it up, but I'm pretty sure this guy called out, God is in the house.
God is in the house, oh, I wish you would come out. so very much. This is amazing to thank you. I'd like to thank you for so many reasons. One is, it's such a vast world of musical mediocrity out there. For you to be a shining artist, it's just
easy.
Don't they say the great ones make it look easy? And also, I want to thank you so very much, you and those concerned and the filmmakers for finally making a film that I've always wanted to see. I've been so sorely disappointed.
Thank you. I
sat there in awe, and I can't wait to be able to tell so many of my friends with complete conviction to come see this.
Well, you know, I've got to say this film was made by Ian and Jane. Ian Forsythe, James Pollard. Okay, thank you. Maybe I'll end on this.
Wait, one question.
Oh.
The one question is, if you were forced to choose... if you were forced to choose one artist in your life, had the most profound effect on you, who would it be?
Like a singing, man.
Not like any artist.
Oh, man, not that.
You have to say Force.
Force?
Yeah. You have to choose.
Well,
I would say
the most effect, you mean, like, the most influence?
Who's enriched your life the most?
That's very difficult. It's a kind of, I don't know, to be honest. Trying to think of anybody.
What about Warren?
Warren Ellis, there you go. Yeah. Warren has certainly expanded the potential of what I do enormously. During Warren, actually, but some years ago, my songwriting was getting around No More Shall We Part, and that sort of stuff, locked into a very difficult piano-led chordal kind of stuff, and he slowly kind of pulled me out of that, I think, because we create music together, and he creates loops, basically, which are kind of linear rather than, you know, bunches of chords with a chorus and that sort of thing. So he freed up everything enormously, and you can really hear that on the way the music and the live stuff's been going. He's had a massive impact. He's great.
So you did have a request, but someone's kind of blooded out.
I mean, haven't you been sitting there for fucking hours?
We haven't.
That guy shot that love letter, and I made a love letter.
He just mentioned it.
And this lady wants to know more, shall we part?
Yes, she does. Yeah.
Flip a coin.
Okay. I haven't played this song before. I don't know why everyone's choosing these songs that are on this very small selection that I have here. That's fantastic.
No more.
200 words we live in hope. Sky hangs heavy with rain. Lovely, lovely. Go get it, go get it. Love letter, love letter. Thank you very much. Thank you. Good night.